Welcome to Cafe Sola and Lord Teach Us to Pray, a Bible study on the Lord's Prayer. In Lesson 1, we will learn about prayer itself. This class is led by Christopher Hogan and was held at Trinity Lutheran Church in Klein, Texas. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for every blessing that you shower on us, Lord. We thank you for this time to study your word, to learn about prayer. And we ask that the meditations of our hearts and the words that we speak be pleasing to you. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. I like to ask questions in Bible study. What things in your life keep you from praying? Do you have things in your life that kind of keep you from praying? What would?
Just busyness.
Busy, okay. Not having enough time.
Well, and not even so much as that you don't have enough time as that you fill your time with other things.
Okay. In your life can keep you from praying. We started off with not enough time. What else could there be?
How about a spirit of unforgiveness?
Oh, I hadn't thought about that one. Well, a couple other things that I thought of was too many distractions in your life. Too much going on. Got to be here, got to be there. That's one. A lack of focus, meaning like you start to pray and you just can't stay there, you know, for some reason.
Sometimes life going too well.
Life going too well. Very good.
You know, you don't think of it.
Not knowing what to say. Do you ever feel like like that's a biggie?
I was going
to
say fear. Kind of, right. Not really having the right words.
Yeah. Oh, there's other people that are really good at praying. Mm-hmm. Right. But I don't know what to say. What do I say? Right. Sometimes it feels a little greedy, maybe. All you ever do when you go to God is ask Him for stuff. God, and that's, I'm doing that a lot right now. So, you know, Lord, I need, you know, you to do this. I need you to do this. I need you to do this. It's like a laundry list. And that's not necessarily a bad thing, but it can be something that you can feel bad about, and then that can hinder your prayer. Sometimes do you feel like you're just going through the motions? It's just another thing to do. I think we can feel that way in church sometimes. You know, we get so comfortable with the prayers that we think we got to start changing them, you know? And it's really, they're good prayers. We just need to like them, you know? Yeah, hear them. You told me and my wife something one time that I will never forget. You said, if you have trouble with the structure of the music of the hymn, just read the words, just say the words. Because that's what really is, it's a psalm, or it's something that we're singing back to God. And I thought, I'm never gonna forget that. That is so good.
I would like to comment on that last there. Sometimes
sure.
I feel like I'm just going through the motions.
Mm-hmm.
And I recognize that the intended there was that it just seems to be a repetition. You begin to question, you know, what's the meaning, and is it really meaningful if it's just repetitious and going through the motions? But it reminds me of that period when I was really sick and at home, and so sick that really all I had left, all I could muster the energy for, was repetition. And that's all I had left. And so there's a reverse side to this as well, that I firmly believe that God heard my prayer, even though it was the least that I could offer.
I had a conversation with somebody the other day where I said, it's not about how many words. I mean, really, is it about how many words you can throw at God? Or is it just, Lord, have mercy?
Yeah. Or, that's it.
Or, God, help me. Or, and I don't mean like in an exclamation where you're using God's name wrong, but literally, God, help me through this. So, I understand. So a lot of these could probably be like, not enough time. Well, really, you know, too many distractions. There's a way to fix that. Lack of focus. I don't know if I can fix that without medicine.
No, that's hard. And I had a personal exercise in that recently. I had gotten a message
from one of my daughters-in-law. I had written an email to my kids, and my daughter-in-law said, I pray the Lord's Prayer. Sometimes I will go through it 40 times at night when I'm stressed, just in my mind over and over and over until I go to sleep. And I'm thinking, wow, I do not do that. I do not do that. So I was, attempting to spend a little time with God that morning, and I thought, okay, I'm going to start with the Lord's Prayer this morning. And as I began to pray, I would be distracted, and I'm like, well, there's one. I didn't make it. And then I'd go start again, and going, okay, I've got to get through this. Well, it took me 9 times, conscientiously trying to keep my mind focused, to finally get from the beginning to the end of it. And sometimes I would even get in a spot and go, what words come next? Where in the world is your mind?
I have been there.
And I struggled with it. It was like kind of embarrassing to reveal.
I have so been there. I've been like, and I have thine. What, it's like you just at some point there's something's going on in your life where you just can't even remember the next thing. You know, I know there's something about trespasses. You know, but so then we have to stop and ask ourselves just basic questions. What is prayer? What are we? What is it? Talking to God. Very good. But it's also a gift from God, right? Prayer is a gift. If we think about it that way, it can have a big effect on the rest of our lives, right? This is something God gave you. You're my child. You know? I give you this gift. And like you said, it's also speaking to God, not only in our words, but sometimes just in what we are thinking about. Luther was really big on saying things out loud. He would say the Ten Commandments out loud and the Creed out loud and the Lord's Prayer out loud every morning. Part of it, I think, is that he thought, maybe a holdover from his Catholicism or something, he thought that that was just throwing all that stuff right in the devil's face.
You know? Maybe that is a way to focus, though.
Yeah.
So sometimes I'm afraid that if we don't repeat certain things enough, that I'll forget them, because there's an amazing amount of scripture in the divine services, the various ones. And when I came across those scriptures later, reading them at some point in time, I was so excited that I knew them already, and I did not realize at that time that that was how I had learned.
I honestly remember not being aware that the divine service was just scripture for a long time, until I started reading more scripture, and I'm like, wait, we say that in the intro, we say that in it's scripture, the whole thing.
Yeah, you know, very
excited
to realize I knew it.
Yeah. Psalm 119, I said this sort of version of it before we started class today. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, or pleasing in your sight. More King James, I guess. Oh Lord, my rock and my redeemer. We say that in the liturgy, right? Before the sermon. Why? Because it's not the pastor who's really speaking. It's supposed to be God who's speaking, right? So that's how we use our mouth, and we confess to God. That's what prayer is. Well, why should we pray? Why even bother to pray?
Way.
Yeah, it's like what we're studying for the next little while. He said, do this, right? So, but you have some people ask this question: if God already knows what we need, even without our asking, what's the point? And the scripture says so. The scripture said God knows what you need before you ask it.
You have to talk to someone to have a relationship with.
Yeah. God could just give you, and he does sometimes, give you what you need. But he wants you to ask. He's told you to ask. Right?
And Christ also told us the story of the persistent.
The persistent widow. Yeah, yeah. Not that you can change God's mind. Not that you can get him to give you something he's not intending to give you. But there's something about, not only because God commanded it, like you started off saying, but also that persistence. He said to them, when you pray, say. It's a command, right? That's from Luke.
begins talking about the Lord's Prayer by talking about prayer itself as a necessity for the Christian. Why is it necessary?
Well, he goes into a lot of detail on this, but the bottom line is, as he says himself in paragraph 2, and we're in the part 3 of his large catechism on the Lord's Prayer, that the devil with all his power, together with the world and our own flesh, resists our efforts. What efforts? Earlier he says, our efforts to keep the Ten Commandments, to live as God would have us live, to be the people he would have us be, and to receive those gifts he would give us. And so for these reasons, Luther says it is absolutely necessary. In fact, he says, quote, nothing is more necessary than we should continually turn toward God's ear, call upon him, and pray to him.
Prayer is a big deal to Luther. And he, as you said just a minute ago, he spends a lot of time here in this first part, simply before he gets into the Lord's Prayer, urging Christians to pray. How does he go about that?
Yeah, it's very interesting. You know, we've seen other portions of the Large Catechism so far where he kind of just jumps right into the subject he's addressing. But here he kind of pauses. And I think we need to, again, understand Luther's historical context and his own life experience. As a devout Roman Catholic, he grew up praying many times a day. This was part of his life as a child and through his school years. And then when he became an Augustinian friar in the monastery in Erfurt, this structured order of prayer that the monastic communities went through every day, where they would pray, you know, 5, 6, 7 times a day, you know, late at night, early in the morning. They would pray through the Psalms. They would pray these orders of prayer. Even though Luther finds fault with a lot of how it was done, the fact of the matter is that it clearly drove home into his heart and his mind and his soul the necessity for prayer.
So, and I don't know if you've ever read the Large Catechism, when he was talking about how Luther kind of talks about stuff a little bit before getting into the first petition, there's the first petition. This is all that Luther wants to say about prayer prior to getting to even the first petition. And he wrote this first, by the way. He wrote the Large Catechism first, and then he kind of summarized it in the Small Catechism. But it says, you know, how ought we to pray? Nothing is so necessary as that we should continually resort to the ear of God, call upon him and pray to him, that he would give, preserve, and increase us in faith and in fulfillment of the Ten Commandments, and that he would remove everything that is in our way and opposes us therein. Those are good things to pray for, right? So since the enemy's out there trying to stop us from being Christians, why, that, there's a necessity to pray. It's not an option, really. Well, to whom shall we pray? That's an easy one, right? Our Father, right? Yes. The one true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Several pastors have said in the past, we pray to the Father, through the Son, by the Holy Spirit. So they're all involved. In various times you ask Jesus for things, or you say Holy Spirit things, blah, blah, blah. But generally we pray to the Father, through the Son, because Jesus gives us the command, and then by the power of the Spirit. We don't pray to saints though, right? Dead people. Mary, for, you know, those kind of things. Oh God, hear my prayer, give ear to the words of my mouth. That's Psalm 54:2. So that's who we pray to, our God, our Lord. If you look in the scripture, it's always, oh Lord, oh God, oh, you know, it's, everything's directed straight to the Father through the Son. Hear my cry, oh God, listen to my prayer. The Lord is far from the wicked, but he hears the prayers of the righteous. That'll come up again in a little bit. That's Proverbs. Well, actually, it just came up now. Whose prayers are acceptable to God?
Prayers of the penitent.
But he hears the prayers of the righteous. Who are the righteous? Those who are right with God, those who are in Christ, those are the prayers that God hears. Whatever you ask in my name, I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. Anything?
According to his will.
Yes. according to his will. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done to you. This is how this came a little later, but if you ask anything in my name, but your God's words have to be abiding in you. That guides your prayers. You could ask for all sorts of things, but they have to be guided by the very word of God abiding in you. Then whatever you wish, because it'll be informed by the word. You know, a prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working, or as some King James say, the prayer of a righteous man availeth much. So much more poetic. But the prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. It's important to keep that in mind. What should be the content of our prayers? This
praise.
One.
Praise.
Praise, okay. Thanksgiving, that goes along with that, right?
I heard a really neat acronym once, and it stuck with me, and it was ACTS, A-C-T-S, and the A stood for adoration, so giving praise and thanks to God, the C stood for confession, the T stood for thanksgiving, and the S stood for supplication and requests, and it just kind of stuck.
And it's good.
It's a good process to try to remember all those. I don't do it all the time.
Our Father who art in heaven, acknowledging God, you know, confession, hallowed be thy name, forgive us our trespasses, you know, thanksgiving. Thanksgiving isn't really in the Lord's Prayer directly.
You're giving thanks
but
to him even for who he is.
By saying our Father who art in heaven, you're kind of acknowledging him for
God,
that.
Hallowed.
Hallowed be thy name. But the word thanksgiving isn't specifically in that. And then, of course, supplication. There's seven petitions. That's what a petition is. Well, our needs. Do you have a need? Pray. Do you know somebody else in a need? Pray. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Philippians 4:6. In everything. There's nothing that's, you know, well, except for praying for dead people. There's nothing that's kind of out of the limits. Give thanks to God for he is good, for his steadfast. Give thanks to God.
I had a very scary traffic incident once where I saw the 18-wheeler that would have hit me had I not had an angel move me out of the way. I mean, it was just one of those things where he ended up stopping inches from the car in the space where I would have been. And I mean, I pray about getting on the freeway. So I don't see an opening, Lord. You're going to have to open it up for me.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, just anything.
And if you spend, like I do sometimes, 3 hours a day on the freeway, an hour and a half going, an hour and a half coming, there's lots of time to pray. You know, Lord, you know, let them, you know, be out of my way. Let me have the strength to not go and tell them how to drive.
Going back to your very first slide when we walked in, was what keeps us from praying, and you know, hearing Sondra talk about, you know, Lord, just open up a space for me on this freeway.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes don't pray because we think God isn't concerned about these little things in our life.
Mm-hmm.
And,
but in everything. Why not pray when you're getting ready to get on the freeway? You know?
Sometimes I think it's kind of easier to pray when you're in a car by yourself. I find that I will say, you know, like this morning, driving out of the driveway and seeing the sunshine, thank you for the sunshine. You know, it just...
Yeah. Yeah. Why not? Thank him for the rain. Thank him for the hurricane. I mean, you know, it's a little harder to do, but it brought us an awareness of when the power was out for so long of our neighbors. We got to know some of our neighbors, you know. So, well, how should we pray? We should pray like beggars, not like Pharisees. What does that mean? How did the Pharisees pray?
I'm so good, you know. Thank you for letting me be so good.
Yeah, exactly.
Really publicly.
And very publicly, and very much to be heard by men. They do these long, drawn-out prayers to get accolades. Whereas if we pray like a beggar,
humble.
We're humble. We're not going to make a big show out of it. And you know, in a restaurant, it's okay to join hands and ask for a blessing, but some people make a big show about it.
Look at me.
You know, and then if you don't tip the waitress, wow, that was a good witness.
Am I imagining things, or is there, I'll call it a children's song about beggar and Pharisee prayer? It's a recalled one years ago.
It's been so long.
Yeah.
The only one I was thinking about is more contemporary, and it's actually, it says, a shiver that stared like a beggar who wouldn't lift his hands.
And really, that's when we're most in need of prayer, probably, and we're more likely to pray. Call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver you, and you shall glorify me. There's so much just in that one verse. But generally, you know, call on God as a beggar the day in your days of trouble. But don't not call on him when times are good. Certainly, praise him and thank him, but... Give ear, O Lord, to my prayer. Listen to my plea for grace. In the name, in the day of my trouble, I call upon you, for you answer me.
The prayers of lamentation, right? So God, you said, ... you are holy, good, righteous, blessing, and my life is miserable. So fix it. that's the Psalm of Lamentation. And you see those prayers and you go, I cannot pray that until you're in the need. And you're saying, why, Lord? How long? Remember, the Bible, the prayer in the Bible is never, why is this happening to me? But how long until it's over? Because it will be. There's always that hope there. So yeah, that's right.
Unless you're Job.
No. I think Job's frustrations come to an end, if I'm not mistaken.
46 chapters of why me, God?
Yeah, right. And then what is God's answer? You don't get to know.
Because of
Job is the book that teaches us, don't ask why, because you're never going to know. Where were you when I set up clouds, right? But rather, how long? And actually, what we find there is Job has found faithful why, because he turned to God with his prayers. He just said, all right, God. I think Job's best line is, the Lord, you know, we always say, oh, Lord, take me up in your hand. I think Job says, oh, Lord, your hand is heavy. You can go away now. You can remove your hand from me. You can leave me alone. You know, interesting. Okay.
That's true. I mean, you ever have a Job season in your life? In that day, you will ask me. In that day, you will ask nothing of me. Truly, truly, I say, whatever you ask of the Father in my name, he will give it to you. That's, I think, talking again about being a beggar. And whatever you ask in prayer, you will receive it if you have faith. These scriptures, taken out of context, which is, you got to be careful about that, could very well be misused, right?
Oh, yeah.
And are misused all the time. I'm only putting them up here because they build a theme, as opposed to trying to say, oh, well, you can ask for anything, and you're going to get it, you know? Because we all should know better than that. We know we have to ask according to his will, right? But yet, it's okay to ask for the impossible, too. Just accepting God's answer when his answer comes. There's nothing wrong at all with saying, Lord, here's a good time for a miracle. You know? Glorify yourself today by performing a miracle. It may not be his day to do that, but you can ask him for it.
Yeah, I think, you know, it's been drilled into me that really the only one thing that we can be assured of regarding God's will is that he desires all of him to be saved. And so when I pray, I'm not going to be sitting there questioning God, okay, God, you know, I want to ask what your will, so therefore I'm going to try to guess what your will is. And to guess the will of God is just ludicrous.
Right.
So I think what it drives you to is to ask God for anything and everything that's on your heart and trust in him that he will provide for you, the child that he loves so dearly. And you may not understand what that provision is,
right.
but it's trust. And prayer for me is one of those tools that God has given us to help build trust in our weak, sinful flesh.
Okay. Yeah, I like that. Yeah. It's not our attempts to change God's mind so much as it's a different perspective on it to say, you know, I prayed for this and this was the outcome. We may never get to see the outcome this side of eternity either, but, you know, that's why some people are real all about keep a prayer journal, I prayed for this and here's how it was answered. But you also have to be open to the idea of I prayed for this and I'm still waiting for an answer, or there's no answer, or the answer was no. Everybody likes to put all the good ones down in their prayer journal, but they don't often put down the times when God said no, you know. Anyway, you were going to say?
I just said, I've been willing to let you know what I thought was the best course of action.
I have done that once or twice. But let him ask in faith, without doubt, with no doubting, for the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea that is driven and tossed by the wind, for that person must not suppose that he will receive anything from it. Okay, here another one that's abused. Okay, just, you know, the power of your ability to not doubt will grant your prayer. No. That's not what it means. It's about a person of faith asking according to God's will. Do you doubt God? Do you doubt God's ability to fulfill his promise and answer prayer? That's a prayer that's asked in faith, is putting the trust in God. If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? That's the best gift, right? The Holy Spirit. But if you're going to give your children... you're not going to give them snakes and stuff like that, right? Why would you ever look to your Heavenly Father and say, he's going to give me something that's bad? That's not going to happen. Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. Jesus even asked that this time of suffering, this cup of suffering, be removed from him. But he was willing to say, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will. So in his human nature, in his humanity, he had that desire. Right? But yet, the willingness to say, not my will, but yours be done. And behold, a leper came to him and knelt before him, saying, Lord, if you will, you can make me clean. He's putting it in God's hands. If you will, Lord. And this is the confidence that we have towards him. If we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. That's why this one's at the end. It should have probably been at the beginning, but it's whatever you ask according to his will. The number of times I've had discussions about that. No, you need to just ask. You don't need to tag on that if it's your will thing. That shows lack of confidence. It shows doubt. No, it puts it in God's hands, and God says, I promise that I will hear your prayers and answer your prayers, and I will. Well, who helps us to pray? Another easy one. The Holy Spirit. Yes, God, the Holy Spirit does. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words.
For words. It's like you just need to know what's going on here.
Can we turn this into more of a human perspective? I certainly don't disagree with what is stated here. From the human side, what helps us to pray? Who helps us to pray? Well, our spouse and our family can help us to pray by either giving us that time or to encouraging us to pray or to encouraging us to pray together.
Mm-hmm.
Those are all helps in prayer. Certainly corporately our church can help us to pray by teaching us what prayer is, like in this class here, and in sermons, in the liturgy. So there are a lot of things. Obviously, number one, it's the Holy Spirit. He's the one that intercedes for us, with us. But there are some human things that actually can contribute toward a enriching prayer life.
Sure, yeah. If you get up in the morning and everybody just starts hitting you right off the bat, they haven't given you time to pray. Have you told them you want time to pray? We kind of assume a lot sometimes, okay? Sometimes I pray before I open my eyes, if I remember to. don't always remember. This morning I started praying and I had one of those moments where it was like my mind was starting to go off because there's just a lot on my mind right now. It's like, well, that's something. If my mind goes off, now I've learned to take this as a clue sometimes. That's what I need to pray for. Where's my mind going? Pray for that.
I think that first part there, likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. I think in the context of that verse, we often interpret that and correctly is that we don't know what to pray for or what to say, and that's the Spirit intercedes for us in our weakness. But I think another weakness that we have that the Spirit also helps us with is we get that yearning, that inclination. You know, I really would like to have a better prayer life, a more enriching prayer life. And I think that's the Spirit working on us. And we often, in our human weakness condition, we fail to communicate that to those that are close to us and around us when it's likely that if they are also filled with the Spirit saint yearning, that it just becomes a communication barrier, not a prayer barrier. Mm-hmm. Or if they just communicate to it again, we would like to improve our prayer life. Right. Do this together.
Right. Which, for the most part, could just be, I want to actually do it.
Yeah.
I want to actually do it. I want to stop and pray.
Yeah, one of the hardest things you ever do is pray out loud in front of anyone.
Yeah. Well, when I first started doing classes, and I realized Gary used to be the one that prayed all the time. Now I've got to do it. Oops. It's not that easy to do. Hopefully it's okay. But also, here's something very cool. For we do not know what to pray for. It's not, that doesn't end there. For as we ought. We do not know what to pray for as we ought. What does that mean? We should know what to pray for. Or we should know how to pray for it. When we're going to pray as we ought, what are we doing? We're praying according to His will. We're praying according to His word. And that's when the Spirit comes in. Somebody said one time, and I hope they were right, they said, if your intention isn't wrong, I guess, like, I want $1 million kind of bad prayer, or the kind of prayer of the Pharisees or whatever, between you and God, the Holy Spirit is kind of cleaning it up, you know. That doesn't mean you can not be concerned about how you pray, but it's just, you know, if you didn't do it perfectly, which we don't do.
He does know the condition.
The Holy Spirit fixes it.
The Spirit of your intentions.
Yeah, yeah. He looks upon the heart, and He knows your real hope isn't to better your own life, it's to care for somebody else.
But, I mean, it says we don't know how, yeah, like we should.
And most of the time, that's probably true. What should happen when we pray? Should the sky open up and light shine down on us? And we get a halo behind our heads? Well, you said this very early on, Mark, but we should, our trust in God should grow as we pray. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will make your path straight. He will make straight your paths. My path is pretty crooked sometimes, so it's nice to know that God's going to straighten it out. But you trust as you pray. I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Harder to trust when you pray and the answer isn't exactly what you prayed for. But that's the moment you need to trust the most. How does God answer prayer? According to His divine will. That's the big thing. In His own way and in His own time.
Yes, no, and later.
Yeah, I like that. Yes, no, and later. Yeah, maybe, no. There's no maybe. God will answer it. It's just whether it's now, never going to happen, or wait. Before they call, I will answer. While they are yet speaking, I will hear, from Isaiah. So before you even get that cry out, God already has heard your prayer. Before they call. And He has already even got the answer. So therefore, it's like, well, then I don't have to pray. No, you got to pray. Three times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. That doesn't mean go out and like deliberately try and be weak, does it? Because then we're more powerful. It's just acknowledging the fact that, you know, we're not perfect, we're weak. And then that passage about the Holy Spirit in our weakness helps us. Might make a little more sense. And we have to realize that God's grace is sufficient. For whom should we pray? That's a good question to ask. Anyone and everyone. Yeah, everyone. Ourselves, our family, our friends, strangers, even our enemies.
Yeah,
which is kind of weird because I didn't know that was going to be a part of the service today. First of all, then I urge you that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving be made for who?
All people.
Except the president. Because we disagree with him. No. Except the people that are killing people over in Africa. No. For kings and all who are in high positions, particularly because they affect our lives, that we may lead a peaceful and quiet life, godly and dignified in every way. That doesn't really mean we get to choose. But I say to you, love your enemy and pray for those who persecute you. Wow. Until you're in that moment. But if you hear this stuff, if the word is dwelling in you richly, as it says, these are the things that are going to come to mind, and these are the things that are going to come out. Right? He has delivered us from such a deadly peril, and he will deliver us again. It says a lot about God. On him we have set our hope that he will continue to deliver us as you help us by your prayers. So there's some benefit to corporate prayer, right? The Our Father can be seen a little bit more personal. This is the prayer, but we do pray it corporately in church, right? And later in the study, we talk a little bit more about the corporate aspect. But as you help us by your prayers, then many will give thanks on our behalf for the gracious favor granted to us in answer to the prayers of many. I like this verse. There's lots of people praying right now for a particular young man. I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. I forget sometimes, if I'm going to be totally honest. I'll tell somebody, oh, that's terrible, I'll pray for you. And I really have every intention of putting that person on my prayer list. And then I get to the rest of my day and it's gone until the next day. Sometimes I'll remember and I'll pray in my car or something like that. But sometimes it's best to do what then? What would be an answer to that problem?
I think I have that same problem, and the solution that I've implemented is if I tell someone that I'm going to pray for them, then I pray for them right then and there. It may not be with them, it may be silent as I go walk to my next task, but that's the best way to keep that promise and that commitment for me.
Anybody else have something? Because that's really good. Maybe a little list.
If I don't write it down, it's gone. So.
Yeah, I've started doing that because I don't want to be bad at that. I know there's no, I'm not earning brownie points or anything, but I just don't want to be bad at that.
Well, whenever you find yourself in a place where you desperately need that support, you know, where you need to feel like there's some people praying for your situation or whatever,
it's just good. I imagine if the Apostle Paul had a prayer list, but it was bigger than the scriptures he carried around, probably. You know. Okay. Who should we not pray for? Dead people. That's it. That's the answer. Why should we not pray for dead people? Because they're dead. Right? They're either where they're with God in heaven or they're not. And praying for them isn't going to get them from one place to the other. Then the woman said, who shall I bring up for you? And he, who's he? Samuel? Saul? Saul? He said, bring up Samuel for me. Why? I don't know. You got to read the whole, all of 28 is good. And all of 1 Corinthians 10 is good too. So Saul died. Why? For his breach of faith. He broke faith when the Lord, with the Lord, in that he did not keep command of the Lord and also consulted a medium seeking guidance. He did not seek guidance from the Lord. Therefore, the Lord put him to death and turned the kingdom over to David. In this moment, Saul should have behaved a little differently. He shouldn't have prayed for the dead or sought the dead. We don't pray for the dead. Otherwise, why would people, what would people mean by being baptized on behalf of the dead? If the dead are not raised at all, why are people baptized on behalf of the dead? You just don't do it, you know? That's kind of another religion's thing, to baptize the dead. And they're trying to get people into heaven because of that. We don't do it.
I think that also, that whole topic about who not to pray for, the verses that you cited, it helps us to understand that prayer is a gift from God. It was given to us in our life in this world as one of those opportunities to develop trust in Him and to communicate with Him.
Okay.
Once we leave this world, we communicate with Him in a totally different way. We see Him face to face.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. Where should we pray?
Anywhere.
Anywhere. Yeah, everywhere. Why limit it, right? In your car, in your backyard, walking around the neighborhood, that's a good time for me when I'm going out on a walk. But yeah, everywhere, especially when we are alone, Luther would advise us. With our family, of course, pray with your family. Nothing like the bond that can be created that way. As long as it's not, Lord, help my son to be better in school. You know, it's all, if you're always kind of chastising people when you're praying around the dinner table, it's probably not the best thing. It's not wrong, necessarily, but if it's, follow the pattern, you know. Our Father who art in heaven, follow the pattern.
Something that we did children at home, praying at dinner was one of those family traditions that we preserved. We would all hold hands together, and then everyone would participate vocally in that prayer. And I think that kind of helps you to keep your focus on away from, you know, chastising your children during the prayer.
I've done that, though. I think so. When I was growing up, you prayed with your hands like this. Maybe it's the Catholic way, I don't know. But it was, we never touched hands. We all just prayed like this. When I got married and started, you know, being around different people with different ways, everybody holds hands. I think that's cool, actually. It kind of connects the family together. But neither one is right or wrong. And when Matthew's, you know, numbers are down, we pray like this. When his numbers are good, we pray like this. So we just got to be careful, yeah.
Just the mechanics of it, the reason we would hold hands around the dinner table is it would allow us still to kind of be focused on the prayer. For me, that means eyes closed and trying to concentrate on that communication with God. But still, you need to let the other person next to you know when you have completed your turn and
a little,
it's now their turn, just a little squeeze on the hand.
I like that.
And it passes it around. So.
I like that. Your turn. You don't have to say your turn, you just squeeze. We do a sort of a tradition at Thanksgiving and holidays where we go around the table and there's a general prayer and then everybody can say something they're thankful for. And then lately they've kind of given it to me to do the open and closing part, but everybody gets their time of being thankful, and I think that's really nice, you know. Makes the food get cold, though.
You know, even in my family, it became very dysfunctional, and, you know, divorced and went on tons of different directions. As a young child, I remember there always being a prayer for food, but it was usually something designated for the oldest male member of the family. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, when it was not anything, we never shared, you know, going around and praying individually,
right,
as a child, but that was kind of an honor position.
Yeah. Hopefully they want to do it, too. When you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. What does that mean?
Seems like it's kind of a specific type of prayer. Maybe. Because if you're supposed to pray continually or without ceasing in your car or whatever, you can't go find a closed room.
Let's look that one up in context, if you have your Bible, because it's a great thing to do, right? But is it saying that everybody has to have a room to go pray in, kind of a thing? So then you go to the whole context, and you read, you know, somebody else want to read? Just start at one and see where it goes. Because this is right before the Lord's Prayer. This is why it's important. So, start at verse 1, somebody.
Be careful not to do your acts of righteousness before men to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. So when you give to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets, to be honored by men. I tell you the truth, they have received their reward in full. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you.
And when you are praying, do not use meaningless repetition. Like who do?
Hypocrites.
The hypocrites, the Gentiles, those who are not, you know, Christians maybe. For they suppose that they'll be heard by their many words. Now, that's the problem Luther had with some of what was going on in the monasteries, was they were praying the Psalms through every day, or every week, I think. But it became just meaningless in a sense. And that can happen to us. You have to just stop and say, Lord, I don't want this to be meaningless. Help me to remember why I'm saying this.
On that too, when you said sometimes your thoughts tangent to what you're praying, but you know, when they go off on some other path, sometimes that's okay.
Uh-huh.
It's, you know, maybe the Lord telling you, you know, here's some focus about this thought.
Or we could get a little puffed up too. We could say, well, my many words are impressing God. My many words are some kind of merit of some kind. I've heard people pray on various TV programs or internet things, whatever, and their prayers go on for like 15, 20 minutes. I don't know. I can't judge that particularly, but it's like, that seems like an awfully long time, you know?
It's all about the intention.
Yeah. I don't really know what's going on with them, but again, it's not about how many words. God says very clearly, don't suppose that you will be heard because of your many words. It's like, simple prayers are okay. So, do not be like them. Do not be like those who pray with wrong intentions, who pray with too many words, meaningless repetitions. And that repetition isn't saying that about what he's about to tell us shouldn't be done on a regular basis. Yeah.
We do it.
Right. You should pray every day. You should probably pray every morning and every evening. But make it not become boring. Not boring, that's the wrong word. Don't let it become meaningless. Don't let it just become something you do.
That you just rattle off.
Yeah.
And not think
That's why he's going to give us a particular prayer.
Verse 7 calls it that link.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think there's another understanding of the word repetitious or repetitions, vain repetitions. In addition to the correct understanding that's already been described, but that is the Greek word there literally means tedium, meaning, and what you're essentially doing, what this verse is describing, is that someone who believes that if they just keep saying it over and over and over again, God will do that thing.
Mm-hmm. Like the persistent widow, or the neighbor that keeps knocking at your door wanting bread. All those are good things.
But here's the difference. The difference in the tense of the words used here is that you are doing it from the standpoint that God won't hear you unless you do it this way.
Mm-hmm.
And God has already promised that he will hear the prayer of the faithful, hear the prayer of the righteous, and we're made righteous through Christ. So essentially what this person who has these vain repetitions, what they're essentially saying is that it's going to be by my righteousness that you're going to hear this prayer, because I'm going to keep telling you over and over and over again, instead of by your righteousness, God, because of your promise, you will hear what my request is.
Yes.
And that's really the distinction that's trying to be drawn here.
I think that is exactly 100% right. It's not about impressing God or anything like that. He's very clearly saying, those prayers God's not going to listen to. You know? Well, what prayer will God listen to? What prayer will God listen to? What would Jesus do to set us a sort of an example? He would withdraw to desolate places and pray. Why? Probably to get away from the crowds that were keeping him from doing what he was going to do.
Well, you know, it's a personal time too. It was one-on-one time with his father. And I agree with Jeff. There are times when you just want to be alone with God, you know, and maybe you have a lot you need to say to him, or maybe you need to sit quiet and hear him, you know, what he might help you to understand. Do that driving in the car, you know, when I'm trying to get on the freeway, or they're different times, and I like the distinction.
Keeping in mind that even in the car, your prayer is a good prayer, but there's distractions. You're trying not to run over people, and you're supposed to be focused on what you're doing. When you're walking, you don't want to trip and fall. I mean, here's something that I just had been studying recently, so I learned this. When you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father, it doesn't say in secret. It says who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. God doesn't have to deal with the visible, right? He can deal a little bit more with the invisible.
The sincerity of your prayer isn't validated by your location.
Or by who sees it, or by who hears it. That's, if you look at the previous verses, it's talking about doing these things in front of people and doing these things to be heard by men. And what he's really saying in this passage is, that's not what counts. What counts is just your conversation between you and God. Now, should you pray at the dinner table in front of other people? Sure. Should you pray in church corporately? Yes. But if you go stand on a street corner and make a bunch of noise, and it's all about look how good of a Christian I am and how much I'm praying, it seems to be going against that. It's like, just take your prayers and go over there and around the corner where it's private and pray.
I think this verse also gives us a clear understanding and teaching that if anyone is to come to us and say, you are too sinful, you cannot approach God, you must now only approach God through me or through this group, or we'll only do it as a group. Uh-huh. This verse is teaching us very clearly that God is asking us individually to come to him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that he will have that personal relationship with us.
Yep.
And it doesn't need to be through through any group of other people.
Right. And even as an individual thing, it's not an individual thing.
It's always with the Holy Spirit.
Because it's always with the Holy Spirit.
Well, you know, and I'm grateful that, you know, conversely, I'm grateful that I've been in settings enough to hear people, women particularly, being a woman, pray, you know, in settings with women and men, of course, too, because those are things I wanted. You know, I wasn't raised as a Christian, and I remember in high school there were girls that were, it was something different, and I wanted whatever it was they had, I really wanted it. I didn't find it until, you know, probably 5, 6, 7, 8 years later. But I wanted that thing, whatever that was, and eventually, you know, through being able to be in the presence of praying people, hearing the prayers of other people, I was kind of closing in on 40 before I could pray aloud. But finally I could do it, and it was a very precious thing to get to share that opportunity. So, both ways.
Thank you. Because that's, a lot of us have trouble getting to that point where we can pray out loud or pray in public. And God doesn't require that we pray out loud. It's just helpful because it's getting it out and back in and out and back in.
And sometimes it's just having the confidence that the thing that you know is a thing that you know. I didn't answer questions in school out loud either. But it wasn't until I knew the Lord and knew that he had some things I could know and trust that I could say those things out loud.
So we're almost there. Regularly and continually is how we should pray. Without ceasing doesn't mean that you never do your job or you never, you know, stop and cook without praying. It doesn't mean that so much as it means don't forsake it. Pray regularly. You see a need, pray about it. You have a need, pray about it. That kind of thing. You see life light flying over. I don't know when I started this. It might have been because of somebody else. Probably was. See life flight flying over. I always pray, Lord, keep the helicopter and the pilot and the doctor safe. Lord, help them to get there in time. And it's just a time to say a quick prayer. So those who dwell at the end of the earth are in awe at your signs. You make the going out of the morning and the evening to shout for joy. It's like morning, evening, daily, regularly. 7 times a day I praise you. Wow. When Daniel knew that the document had been signed, he went into his house where he had windows in his upper chamber. Remember, he went and faced Jerusalem, and he got down on his knees 3 times a day and prayed, right? Muslims pray, what, 5 times a day or 7 times a day or whatever. But he was doing it 3 times a day, and people saw him in the window. That's a whole other story, and that got him in trouble. But he wasn't going to stop because he gave thanks before God. When should we pray? We should pray. And he told a parable to the effect that they ought to always to pray. Always. And never lose heart just because, well, I prayed for this and it didn't happen. Just pray. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Jesus for you. That's hard, giving thanks in all circumstances. Call upon me in the day of trouble and I will deliver you and you shall glorify me. Yes. Well, what prayer did Jesus give us to pray? We call it the Lord's Prayer. It also could be called the Our Father, because it starts out that way. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Let's say this together, folks. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
So let's talk about the Lord's Prayer. This is a huge subject. We need to clear away some of the misconceptions about this prayer. First of all, when we recognize it as the Lord's Prayer, what exactly do we mean by that?
Yeah, this is a very important point, and it's quite striking when you look at the account of the Lord's Prayer given, I believe particularly in Matthew. It is said But Jesus doesn't say, when you pray, pray like this. The Greek is very clear. It says, when you pray, say this. And he gives these words to be used by his people. The Lord's Prayer is not optional. The Lord's Prayer is a wonderful model and pattern and outline for all subsequent prayer, but it is not simply an outline for prayer. That's a great misconception I see floating around among Christians, particularly Protestant evangelical Christians who may not use the Lord's Prayer as part of their devotional life as much as has been the pattern in the Western Church since day one, or for that matter, the Church Universal, East and West. The Lord's Prayer are the very words of our Lord Jesus Christ that he has given to us to use when we pray.
When you pray, say. That's the important part. And is this prayer merely meant to be a pattern of how to pray? It is, but is that what it's...
It's both.
It's both, yeah. It's say these words. Don't forsake these words for your own words, necessarily, but inform your words by these words. It's very important. And if you look at good prayer, it follows a similar pattern. You start out by acknowledging God and his control, and it's things like, give us our daily bread, Lord. You know, your will be done. Forgive me my sins, as I hopefully forgive other people.
And no mistakes in that prayer. That was great.
Yeah. It's been said there's not a word in there that's extra. It's like every single word is just it, you know. And that takes us to next week, where we will hopefully cover both the introduction and the first petition, so we can then do one petition after that a week. And they are the Our Father, who art in heaven, and hallowed be thy name. Anybody have any last comments before we close in prayer?
Just a little trivia.
Okay.
When he was speaking in that last audio segment about the word, the Greek word that Christ used, it was really literally meant pray this what? And pray, say these words.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that Greek word is lego. But what it literally means is to lay forth. Kind of gives you a concept, if you ever play with Lego blocks, that you lay them in a particular fashion. And so it's just a trivia.
Yeah. It's very often translated, even in Matthew, as when you pray, pray like this. But it's really saying when you pray, pray thus.
Yeah.
Pray this way. Pray these words. And then pray other ways. But it's like, don't forsake the Lord's Prayer. Well, let's go ahead and close. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to gather together to be about the study of your word, to go into depth on the Lord's Prayer that you gave us to pray. Help us, Lord, to remember to pray this prayer continually, regularly. Help us to allow it to inform our regular daily prayer life. Just bless all those who showed up today, Lord. Lead and guide us this week as we go about our daily vocations and tasks, and help us to stay prayerful and just lead and guide us, Lord. And we ask this all in the precious name of your Son, our Lord. Thank you for watching this Bible study on the Lord's Prayer. Lord, teach us to pray. Lesson 1 on prayer. You can also find us on Facebook or subscribe to us on YouTube and receive notifications when additional Bible studies are posted.